workshop on sustainable investment session, right? Yes? Thank you for coming. We have three presentations from our different perspectives about sustainable investment. Please raise your hand, ask questions, throw stuff at us. No. really, just say anything you want throughout the whole session. We will open up for discussion after the presentations as well, and also do an exercise. Do you have the innovation cards? Have you been using them? Yeah? We will collect them at the end of the session. So think about what you're going to write and scribble down on your innovation cards. Does anyone not have one? Everybody has one. Who are you? No. Who does investment for a living? Who works in investment or finance? Yeah? Who works in business? Big business or small business? Small business? Any entrepreneurs? Okay. Who works in government? Oh, good. We can just say whatever we want. anything else? Consultants?
Who hasn't put up their hand?
I work on a non-profit.
Sorry? Non-profit organization.
Non-profit.
Perfect.
What an error. So non-profit, to not include non-profit was an error, not working in non-profit. We have for-profit business and we have non-profit as well. So I think, just so we know, if you have trouble understanding us, go to this side of the room. Do you want to say that again?
일본어での 번역들과 오디오스타가 있으니까 こっち側に 이동시켜 주세요.
Please feel free to move. We'll have more help on the left side of the room. And then, do you want to do? Should we do quick introductions while we get the slides up? Now that we kind of know who you are, Lisa, do you want to introduce yourself? Environmental issues primarily. Social issues? Both?
Both.
They're all connected, but I think Lisa's presentation will focus on green bonds and environmental investment and social. Okay. Shravan?
Yeah. Hi. So my name is Shravan Shankar. I'm based in Chennai, India, and I both run a startup. As well as my team will go my startup as well. So it works to help entrepreneurs and freelancers to get their business started. We give them a platform for that. And I also work as a consultant to support sustainable business with a focus on the financial case for sustainability focused projects.
And I'm Amanda.
Hi,
I live in London. I worked for many years with business, with John Elkington and Volans in the UK, Power of Reasonable People, working with big companies to think about how they can play a role in changing the world. And one piece of work I did was on corporate venture capital, so thinking how corporates are investors, which has now gotten me here in the investment world. Business and investment are very connected, but for investment, I now work at a fund between the US and the UK, where we invest in social and environmental businesses. property social impact bonds. It's called Bridges Ventures. And what I, my role is to share with the world what we've learned about investing in social or environmental businesses, and also how we might in the future communicate with each other better about not only financial expectations, but also our impact expectations of everyone in this room, of businesses, entrepreneurs, and investors. So with that, pass over to Lisa to kick us off. Any questions before we go? Good? Can you understand us? Oh, that's another thing. Maybe if we need to slow down, can someone just raise their hand?
Well, the global capital markets stand at $150 trillion today. So that means we need to be investing less than 5% of current global markets in these areas of need. You'd think we'd be able to organise ourselves to achieve this. The point is, we actually have the capital, often we have the technology, we have the initiatives, but the connection isn't quite there. So how can we shift incentives to move global capital markets into sustainability challenges? I'm going to introduce bonds as agents of change. So bonds actually make up the world's largest asset class. I'll go back to the chart. As you can see here, this represents the global bond market, the biggest chunk, $88 trillion currently, 2015. So bonds are basically debt. It's an IOU. A bond issuer issues a bond, receives financing, and then they pay interest over a period of time. So, and also, bonds actually have a pretty bad reputation in terms of it's considered a boring asset. It's been around for a long time. It's not as quote-unquote risky or has such high returns traditionally as investing in stocks and shares, for example. It's been overlooked, particularly from a sustainability angle, which is incredible when you think about it's the largest asset class in the world, and yet sustainable investment mainly focused on the equity side so far. Maybe in stocks and shares, sustainability strategies, and there are a number of impact funds that are very much involved in private equity. And the point is, we've been focusing on sustainable investment in an asset class that isn't the largest asset class. We really need to be thinking about how to tap into bonds. And why should we tap into bonds? Actually, it's very well-suited structure for creating impact today, because you can front-load impact. The point is, you borrow so that you can fund the project today and deliver the project, and you can service that debt over time. It also shifts incentives a little bit, because if you receive equity investment, you actually have to focus often on maximizing shareholder returns. So if someone holds your equity, so some ownership in you, you have to constantly create more financial value. There's a bit more of that pressure. Even if you are a mixed purpose, like a mission-led organization, the tension's still there. The tension for servicing debt is slightly different. Often you know what your expenditures are, and it's less of a focus on maximizing shareholder return on the financial side, which is why I'm going to argue that we should be looking at bonds as an agent for change. So equities don't have their role, it's just that bonds need a bit of a shout out, it's been overlooked. So I'm going to introduce a particular type of bond, which is the use of proceeds impact bond. Has anyone here heard of a green bond? Out of interest? Great. And basically, a green bond, as we understand it today, emerged first in 2008, it basically follows the World Bank Green Bond Model. And we're very lucky at Affirmative in that we have the person who actually designed the criteria for this bond as our sustainability. So we know the structure well. So it's very simple. It's basically take a normal standard bond structure, like a nil bond, but add some more conditionality to it. So the idea is you have to define what you're borrowing for. You can't just say, I want to borrow 500 million. You have to say, what is it you want to borrow for? Two, you have to explain your process of selecting the type of projects that you're looking for. Say it's a green bond and you want to invest in renewable energy projects. Well, how do you choose these projects to invest in? It might be a company wanting to switch to renewable energy, unless we have to be along with that. Three, how do you manage these proceeds? Do you track it over time? So once you borrow, are you responsible enough to show how you spent the capital? And four, reporting. So you say what you've achieved, and often, increasingly, that means impact reporting, not just, well, I borrowed 500 million, I spent 300 million on renewable energy, I spent the rest on energy efficiency. So that's the basic structure of a use of proceeds impact bond, which is currently dominated by green bonds. So you can see here the break of the colours. So the light green represents the green bond market, and the grey the social bond market. So we've seen a lot more green issuance than social issuance so far. In fact, the green bond market has absolutely exploded. You see the chart on the left, growth has been phenomenal, and since 2013, the market's just taken off. We now have about 190 billion total impact bond market, over 160 billion in green bonds. So I will talk about an actually specific case. I'll start with the social bond, which is IFM. And actually IFM has historically been very popular in Japan. I don't know if anyone's heard about it, but it was often being bought by Japanese investors as well. IFM's a really interesting structure. So basically, it's actually IFM itself is just a funding company. And it is able, it receives foreign country donor pledges. So different countries pledge they want to invest, they want to give aid towards immunization and vaccination projects around the world. But often when you put a pledge forward, you're not going to disclose all the money on day one. So you say, over a period of 5 years, I want to commit 1 billion to immunization in developing countries. But you can stagger how you, or when you disclose, disperse these funds. So if it basically collects the pledges, so it says, well, over the next 10 years, we know that we're going to be receiving this grant money. And then it issues today. So I know I'm going to be receiving in excess of 5 billion over the next 10 years. I want to issue a half a billion bond today. And what that means is that it can give those proceeds to Gavi, which is a global factory alliance. It's an NGO that works with different governments and also pharmaceutical companies to basically bring in vaccination programs aimed at children in some of the world's poorest countries with very weak health infrastructure. So an incredible fact is that IFM's actually raised over 5 billion in the bond markets last year on these donor pledges that would otherwise only be available over 20 years. So you think about it, an incredible front loading of impact. In 20 years, a lot of children have been born that have received vaccination where otherwise they wouldn't have. And then the argument is that actually not only are you having a great social impact, but actually all those countries that are receiving these vaccination programs are also saving money because if you immunize and you've got a healthier population, you have less healthcare costs. So the government cooperation towards these projects is very high. So that's an example of a social bond. And another example is GreenCo. This is a green bond, and it's very interesting because it's an Indian renewable energy company. So India's ranked as the 50th most countries, the 50th most vulnerable to climate change country in the world. It's heavily dependent on coal, has very ambitious renewable energy targets as well, but yeah, it's still coal is the dominant energy provider in India. And GreenCo is a dedicated renewable energy power company. It issued a green bond. This is the second ever green bond. GreenCo is a small company. It's below investment grade, and it was able to attract interest globally. So it had European investors, US investors that purchased this bond, and it was its only second ever bond. So many investors had no idea who GreenCo were before they issued the green bond. And they were able to raise finance in eight renewable energy projects, wind and hydro projects across India, very successfully. And they argue at a very attractive interest rate compared to their previous experience. So I'm just going to leave to quickly summarize basically some of the key themes here. I think we're going to cover some of these as well in future finance, but I'm going to highlight kind of one here. Given current rates of growth of the impact bond market, we're actually targeting towards a $1 trillion market within 5 years. Now that's still not enough to meet that $7 trillion a year UN Sustainable Development Goal target, but it's a hugely broad. And I really want to encourage thinking, I think often in sustainable investment, sometimes we think too small. There is a big case, I used to be micro investments as well, so the case of investing with intention what a better word, in small amounts and taking time to understand the company certainly has its place, but a lot of our challenges, they're on our doorstep, so we have to address them. So we need to think about mainstream solutions to attract big money quickly, and really I think the green bond structure, the use proceeds structure, can really help us to build that. And there's been a lot of different types of issues. Japan's actually been quite active, so the Development Bank of Japan, Toyota's also issued a green bond. So if any of you are working in business do you have initiatives that you would, that could be financed using a green bond, and or a social bond? Because in Japan, also one of the government agencies also issued a social bond. So that's one of the thoughts I'd like to leave you all as well. If you're in a smaller business, how do you aggregate and get you people group together and help organise these appraisals bond structure? Because there's certainly a lot of investor demand. It's been a very successful growth story, but we need to keep the momentum up if we want to meet that substantial investment gap and solving that sustainability challenge. That's it from me.
Infrastructure are the two largest sectors. Mm-hmm.
Actually, green infrastructure probably and that includes for example low carbon transport, so electric rail for example, and it's on the agenda for a lot of developing countries as well. And renewable energy and energy efficiency initiatives, so cleaning up the supply chain for example, or retrofitting buildings to make them more efficient is a key sector. The more climate change adaptation focused projects, so less about carbon savings but helping communities adapt to the effects of climate change, so for example sustainable farming or forestry type projects, they're still a smaller part of the market, but actually there's a lot of investor interest. That's one of the frustrations. Well, how do we find these types of projects? Because there are certainly a lot of players in this area that actually find them and understand their models. So there are growth sectors, and I think as we go along with more assurance, we will see more different types of sectors.
And the last little grey area in terms of how it's going to evolve. Is the area as of now where it's still evolving? Or?
It's still evolving. So this market first appeared in 2008 and really took off in 2013. It's a young market, and you've got some countries that have just started to embrace it. So last year, for example, China was the dominant issuer, and they just come into a top-down way that China's actually got green bond regulation as to what the green bond, and they're using it to finance a lot of infrastructure, green energy, for example. Some of the more controversial bits, such as clean coal, which the international investor community is very wary of. But there's a gray area in terms of like new players are coming to market and new types of bonds. So actually, for example, Poland and France actually issued the first government-led bonds, for example. So not just companies or development banks issuing. So I think as with any new market, things can change pretty quickly. Which is one of the reasons to your question, as investors, we have to be very, it's our responsibility to know what we're investing in, and we need to look at it quite rigorously and robustly as to what type of overall impacts we're looking for associated with the bond, because things will change because it's a young market and there is momentum.
I have two simple, more technical questions. One is, what is the interest rates that that people are paying to access the funds? And secondly, you mentioned that sometimes they were too small for this kind of bonds or investment. So what is considered small, what is considered appropriate, and what is considered big?
So what interest rates, that's a really tough question because at the end of the day it depends on what type of issuer you are. So say you're a small emerging market issuer, you'll be paying higher rates of interest. And again, it depends which country you are, but I can tell you that it's market competitive. So you're not going to be attracting a lower interest rate or a higher at the moment. You'll just be attracting an interest rate that reflects how the market currently prices. Regardless of whether you're a green or a social orientated business. We have to slightly size it because it's just too broad. And in terms of sizing, because the green bonds and social bonds have been very much an investor demand driven type of investment, so investors want to be mainstream investors, I should say. And they are typically looking for larger sizes. You'll hear a lot of investors, we're not one of them, who ask for a benchmark appropriate size, and that means that it's a size that they can, the bond issue has to be of a similar size to other sort of large corporate issuers, just because they benchmark themselves on a mainstream index where the largest size of issuance, so that's about 350 euro, 500 million. But you are seeing now, and we're one of those investors who actually want to be looking for more high impact, but potentially smaller size issuers. And there, it depends. Like, for example, I've looked at bonds that are 5 million euro. I've actually looked at ones that are below 5 million. At the end, we couldn't invest them because they were a bit too small for us. doesn't mean there aren't other investors who will. The point is that, as I said, it is a growing market, so there are still more new investors coming. So I think we'll actually see a bit of shift in terms of how big, or in terms of sizing and interest rate expectations over the next year.
So I'm asking,
yeah.
What are the usual investment periods as such, as of now? Like, what are the investment periods the investors look at?
Oh, okay. So again, it depends on what type of fund.
Yeah. High impact for those kind of investors, or looking at high impact?
Oh, sorry, the types of investors.
Yeah, no, I'm saying what are the exit periods that high impact investors are looking at?
So these bonds are liquid. There's a very, because there's such high investor demand, if you had one of these bonds, you could sell it probably instantly.
Okay.
And again, it depends on what type of bond it is. If it's above investment grade, you're more likely to find more buyers compared to if you're below investment grade, but that's just the way the market works. It varies, and at the end of the day, it depends on what the investor's preferences are. For us, for example, we have different preferences for different countries, and that's because we compare ourselves to major investors. We prove that you can invest in green and social bonds and achieve a financial return that is equivalent to investing in non-green and financial, but you get all the additional green and social impacts. We definitely have the tenor expectations that match the current market conditions. So that's our philosophy, but you'll find some others that want to buy and hold.
So I work out and I run a regional commercial bank in Ethiopia here.
Okay.
And I am very impressed to hear that you mentioned the size of the impact growth market is about approximately 5%
of
the total capital market.
Yeah. Oh, no, sorry. Not the impact bond market. Impact bond market. So the need for investment
need for
is about 5%.
Because the market itself in Japan is very small. I think it's very, very small. And I think promoting such small businesses and to solve such problems, or social problems, using impact bonds, very important to come. So my question is how, like commercial banks in Europe or America, how do they sell these bonds, and how are they committed to selling these social type of bonds, and who are the players, and who, how they organize, and how do they sell these bonds to individuals and local markets?
So you actually do have Japanese commercial bank issuers, so SMBC has actually issued a green bond, the one called a sustainability bond, was effectively a green bond, and you actually see a lot of financial institutions issuing green bonds. So for example, Bank of America has issued a green bond, a number of European banks, such as the Scandinavian Bank, SEB, GSBB, there are a lot of commercial bank green bond issuers. And really they go about it, so one of these types of names, you will find a lot of investors are a little skeptical. For example, from Bank of America issues a green bond, the immediate question is, well, yes, your green bond finances, what looks like pretty good projects, but what's the rest of the bank doing? That's an perspective we take, we take integration. There are some investors who are just very happy to, because of the proceeds are ring-fenced, purchase green bond without considering the sustainability impacts of the rest of the bank. So a range of investors again. I think for a commercial bank, you have to have a very strong articulation of your process of selecting the projects that are to be financed, and how you monitor it. So I mean, often, usually, a commercial bank can say granting a loan onto these businesses that may be having these social impacts. So how do you analyze these businesses, for example? How do you monitor them to make sure they are delivering on what they promise? And also, that would help to, I think, generally let investors know broadly as a bank, what type of activities are you involved in? Are you sustainability aware? I would say there are some investors where it would be a problem if, say, you know, less than 1% of your financing goes towards sustainability and like the rest of it is in that like, whole arm, you know, everything else you can think of. So there could be a real issue there. Not that I'm saying we have to be kind like that, just as an example. So really just, it's the information process, and in terms of how to issue, it's pretty much the same as how all issuers issue bonds. You go through, there are different brokers, so you contact the investment banks, for example, and they help you structure and they introduce you to different investors. There are a lot of banks that are very specialist in it, and in Japan, and there are a number as well, and using some suggestions as well, and it's very